Well, good evening, and thank you for joining us tonight here at our weekly prayer meet. I'm so glad that you're here. I hope that you're looking forward to this time like I am. I like to circle it on my calendar each week and just join you together as we're praying for each other and we're praying together to God and just asking Him to do what only He can do. I'm so grateful for this time. Hey, don't forget, that's what this is. It's a conversation. It's a conversation between us. It's a conversation between us and God. And so part of that is we want you to talk and dialogue. So in the comment section below, whether you're watching it live or you're watching it later, you can put your prayer requests in there. We'd love to pray for you, or as you see prayer requests pop up, you pray and just ask God to do what only He can do. I'm excited to be back. I thought the last couple of weeks have just been incredible times of prayer. It's been awesome. On nights I haven't been leading the prayer meeting, I've been able to be at home, and it's about the time we put our kids to bed, so we'll kind of watch the prayer meeting together, and it's just been a fun time to kind of talk to my kids about what prayer means and what it looks like and why we pray. And so, man, I just hope you enjoy this as much as we do. And so don't forget, you can drop your prayer requests in the comment section below, whether you're watching it live or watching it later. Well, tonight I want us to pray through Scripture again, so turn your Bible to 1 Corinthians chapter 13. This is kind of a famous chapter in Scripture. You've heard it. Undoubtedly, you've probably heard it at a wedding. But nonetheless, we're going to pray through 1 Corinthians 13, particularly just one verse really tonight, and just really ask the Lord to begin to search us. You know, we've said repeatedly every week that our prayer is for revival and awakening. Revival isn't something that happens to us in mass, but it's something that God does to Christians individually. He revives us. He leads us to repentance and rejuvenation. And then through revival of the church, of the individuals, He uses us for the awakening. And so that's one thing we really desire deeply here at Indian Springs, is that God would use us to be a part of a great awakening in our communities, in our state, in our nation, and throughout the whole world, that the name of Christ would be lifted up and people would be saved. And so tonight we continue down that journey, continuing to pray for revival. It's this constant prayer of revival that we practice. It's this constant prayer of revival that we go back to every day and just ask God to search our heart, to cleanse us of unrighteousness. So tonight we're doing that from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Before we read the text, let me just pray and just help us kind of quiet our souls and clear our minds and think intently upon the Lord. So just pray with me right now. In Jesus' name we pray that these next few moments together, doing the hard work of prayer, doing the necessary work of prayer, doing the faithful work of prayer, God, we pray that You would meet us right where we are, on our couches, in our cars, wherever we may be. Lord, that You would meet us here, and Holy Spirit, that You would calm us, bring a sense of quietness over our minds, over our thoughts, that these next few moments, we would just be able to walk into our proverbial prayer closet and shut the door behind us, God, and just be standing there with You. That our attention would be singly focused, that our thoughts and our attitudes and our actions would be focused on giving You the most amount of glory that we can. Thank You for the opportunity to pray. Thank You for sending Jesus to die on the cross for our sins and in our place, to be our great intermediary between us and You, Father. So, Father, now we pray in Jesus' name, all of this, amen. Well, let's go ahead and look at our text tonight for just briefly for a moment. 1 Corinthians chapter 13. You can follow along with me. I think it's going to be on the screen also. We'll walk through this and then we'll start our prayer. So let's get after it. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 1. If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Look at verse 4. Love is patient, and love is kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable, or it is not resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoings, but rejoices with truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part. But when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. And when I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now, faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love. So we've probably heard 1 Corinthians chapter 13, like I said before, many of times, perhaps at a wedding or perhaps at a funeral or some special event. And I think that's okay, but I think primarily what we need to understand is Paul here is talking to the local church at Corinth. He is actually rebuking them, I guess you could say, or reproofing them, or he is trying to correct them to some of their issues. You see, Paul wants the church in Corinth to be as strong as she can be to win the world for Christ. But they have these different issues that are popping up, and so Paul is trying to hold them accountable. Paul's not trying to show them how sinful they are based on how good someone else is. Paul is just saying, look how you're acting compared to how God would have you to ask, because God is the ultimate standard. Paul wants the church to be effective, and he knows that with sin rampant, it can't be. Obviously, that's something that we know too. We've been praying for revival, and we know that praying for revival starts with repentance. And we want God to do something good within us and great through us, but we know first that he's got to move those things out of our life that are preventing that. So Paul here is talking to the church at Corinth about these different issues. Well, chapter 13, it kind of takes a little bit of a turn before he gets back to his main point. He begins to talk about ministry, and he talks about love. Particularly in chapter 12, Paul is talking about the spiritual gifts. And you have some people in the church there that they hold their gift in higher esteem than others. You know, it's always the person who is the better teacher thinks that they're more they're important than the person who holds the door. Well, Paul says, well, not at all. What your gifting is has nothing to do with your place of importance. It's a gift from God, so it can't have anything to do with you. And then Paul goes into 13 and says, no matter what your gifting is, there is one element, there is one characteristic that you should all hold above everything else and that makes all things equal. What is it? Love. Love is an interesting word. You know, we often throw the word around. Perhaps we'll talk about a relationship, or perhaps we'll talk about our favorite kind of ice cream, or we'll talk about our favorite event from the weekend. And so love, it's really hard to define. Perhaps you remember when you told someone, hey, I'm in love with that person. They said, well, how do you know? And then you just kind of fumbled around with your words for a few moments. Because love really is something that's kind of difficult to define. And Paul gets that. That's why Paul here says, here's what love is, and here's what love is not. And so for Paul, the way you define love is context and concentration. So that's what we want to do tonight. We want to ask God some questions about ourselves and see what we find out in prayer. We really want to see, man, where do we fit with what Paul says is good love? And where do we fit with where Paul says is not good love? So that's what we're looking at tonight. So let's look at number one. Love is patient. Look at verse 4. Paul says, love is patient. So on the screen, there's going to be some questions, but before we get there, let me just say this about patience. You may say to yourself, well, Matt, I'm not a patient person. I can't wait for anything. I don't necessarily know that this is the same kind of patience, although I think you could probably say it's in the ballpark. I think when we say love is patient, we're really talking about how does our love interact with other people? How do I express my love for people who make me mad? How do I express my love for people whom I think is wrong? How do I express my love for people who drive me crazy? I think that's the question. I think that's what we're focusing on. I think that's what Paul is saying. True love shows itself in those situations where you're probably your most annoyed. So that's what we want to look at. So take a few moments right now, read through the questions on the screen, and pray and ask God to give you love that is patient. Well, amen. Amen. Don't forget, if you're joining us live or later, please drop your prayer requests or comments, I guess, really, in the section below on YouTube or Facebook, and we're just joining together and praying. And if you're posting later, we can pray later. We're always kind of monitoring this feed. So, man, we just want to have a conversation of prayer together, and so make sure you do that. Well, love is patient, and that's something I was getting actually impatient last night with one of my kids trying to get them in bed. And I had already studied for this, and the Lord just, I don't know, He just kind of flicked me on the back of the head and said, so you're going to go and tell people tomorrow night to practice patience, but you can't. And so I thought, yes, Lord, so I'm right there with you. But love is patient, and we practice that even in the most difficult situations. So the second element we want to look at tonight is right there also. Look back at verse number 4. Love is patient, and it is kind. So we often think about kind, and we often think about, well, what does that mean, or kindness just means smiling or whatever, but love being kind is very intentional. In fact, there should never be something that characterizes a Christian other than kind, that we should never have the opposite of kind as Christians. We have the greatest gift in the world that was given to us by God in Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of our sins and eternal life, and so we have every reason to be kind to everyone else. To look at everyone else, not as pitiful, but as someone who is a direct imagination of God, someone who represents God and that they are made in His image. And so, may we treat people kindly because of how God treated us. You know, we were talking right before we came on the air tonight about how the Bible says that we all deserved wrath. That's what the Bible says. But God, being rich in His mercy, even when we were dead in our sins and trespasses, sent Christ to die for us. So God did that for us even when we were at our worst. And I think for Christians, love, particularly in the context of church and for believers, love is being kind even when it's difficult. So take a few moments. The questions will be on the screen. Pray through them and just say, God, am I kind? Does my love demonstrate itself in kindness towards other people? So pray now. Amen, amen. One thing I should have mentioned earlier, as we're thinking through this characteristics, one thing we should also think through is the characteristics of love that play themselves out in our daily life are really missional. Or maybe better stated is they are missiological characteristics. When we practice the positive aspects of love, as Paul says, they become part of our mission tool chest, if you will. They help us speak into the lives of people who need to hear Jesus, right? You're much more likely to hear good news from someone who is being kind to you than someone who's being rude or mean or inconsiderate, right? And so I think that's part of Paul's teaching here too, is when love is elevated and everything comes out of that, it becomes beneficial not just for the church, but for the mission of the church. And so when our love manifests itself through patience and kindness and other things like that, it becomes missiological in its kind of endeavor. So I should have mentioned that earlier, but just think through that too as you're going through this, is Lord, how can this help me on mission? So don't forget, if you have a prayer request or comment, drop that in the comment section below, whether you're watching live or later. We can pray with you and we can just dialogue together about what the Lord is doing. So Paul does something really interesting here. Not only does he say, here's what love is, but he also, as we're about to see, also tells us what love is not. Paul is trying to clear up the gray area. He wants to make it really a black and a white issue. It's either this or it's nothing. And so we see that now. Now look back at the text with me, 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4. So he says, love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. So let's look at that. Love does not envy. Have you ever found yourself in the position where you are unable to celebrate with others in the church, maybe because of their talent or because you just think, you know, maybe that should be me, or maybe that's not you, but somebody you know struggles with that? Here's what envy does. Envy, oftentimes in the church, it causes us to take our focus off God and His glory, and it really causes us to put it on other people. Perhaps you've been somewhere, and the whole time you're sitting there, all you can think about is what someone said about you or to you, or all you can think about is what can't believe that person is wearing up there, or whatever. I know those are kind of goofy examples, but that's kind of what envy does. Envy lets other people have control of your mind when really God should be the focus. And so what Paul is saying here is love does not envy what other people have. Particularly in this context, love does not envy someone else's spiritual gift, right? Let's go back to the earlier example. We need good teachers. But guess what? We also need people to open the door and welcome people. And so what Paul says is there isn't this ladder of what's more important than the other. God gives gifts, not for our own edification, but for the glorification of Him. And so that's something we have to continually be careful about is, Lord, let me not be envious about anyone else, but keep my focus on You. So let's take a few moments right now and let's just pray through these questions and really search our heart and ask the Lord, if we're not struggling with this, to keep us from struggling with this, or if we are struggling with this, to change our heart. Because here's what we know. If God doesn't change, it's just not going to change on its own. So take a few moments and let's pray through this now. You know, just kind of thinking through that point, I think one of the things the church can do that helps strengthen her and create future worshipers and leaders is continually celebrate and encourage people with talents, abilities, whether it be serving, whether it be, you know, performing, so to speak, or teaching, whatever it may be, is, man, every time we get a chance, let's recognize and acknowledge somebody. You know, one thing I remember, Pastor, when I first started out in the ministry, one thing that he did is every time he saw a piece of trash, he picked it up on the church campus. That's just what he did. He wanted to be the leader. And eventually the staff started doing that. Well, what he would do is when he saw us pick up a piece of trash, he would always come over and say, hey, great job. Thank you so much. You just served the kingdom and the king. Pick up a piece of trash. I say all that to say this. It actually encouraged us and kind of fueled us to keep doing it. And so that's what we want to do as a church. We want to be a church. We want to be a people that encourages other people with good and special gifts from the Lord. So just wanted to say that. Don't forget, if you have a prayer request, whether you're watching live or later, drop that in the comment section below so we can all pray together about that. We're going to round third and head home tonight, just kind of as we finish up before next week. We're going to save some for next week, all right? But Paul starts out with these love is positives and then the love is negative aspects. So we want to finish up here tonight with what Paul says love is not. So let's look at that again. Return to the text. Let's look at chapter 13, verse 4. And I'm going to read that whole verse for you. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. So, love does not boast. You know, I think boasting is something that almost all people at some point are guilty of, whether they mean to or not. Certainly, I would never say this is a bad thing, but if you're a grandparent, you know exactly what it means to boast on your grandkids. And that's okay. That's not what we're talking about here. But you get the idea here of at least what boasting is. And so what Paul is saying here is it's not your place and it's not right to boast in what God has given you or the ability that God has given you. Because what we're doing when we boast about what God gives us or what we have from God is somehow we elevate ourselves above other people. Well, because God has given me this gift, I'm more important than you. We may not say it like that, but oftentimes that's what Paul is getting at. That's where some of the fractures in the church were. People who had the gift of teaching thought that they were, you know, higher and more talented than the people who had the gift of service or prophecy, or people who had tongues thought that they were just the penultimate of all of the gifts. Paul says, no, love does not boast. And if love is the primary characteristic and it trumps all things, then love does not boast. And Paul, I don't think, is really making the point right here, but I think he does make the point in most of his writings, is that as Christians, we can only boast in one thing. You ready for it? And that's Christ and Christ crucified. We boast in the fact that God had a plan. We boast in the fact that God is good. We boast in Jesus' perfection. The boast is always about how good God is. And so what happens there is I'm eliminating the attention from myself and I'm putting it on God. I'm extending and expanding His glory throughout His earthly kingdom and hopefully into eternity. And so that's the idea here is that, you know, it's okay to boast on your grandkids, but the question is for us as believers in the church, who is the center of my attention or what is the center of my attention? Because what is what we love. In other words, what I love the most will be that which I talk about the most. So these are really kind of deep questions we're thinking about for our own heart is, what consumes me? What do I talk about the most? What do I brag about the most? Is it God? Or is it something else? So take a few moments. Read through the questions on the screen and just pray. Just spend some time with you and God, and ask God to help search your heart and to remove all those things that would make us boastful people. So take a few moments right now. Well, amen, and thank you for joining us tonight. What an incredible evening of just walking through the text and just asking the Lord to search our heart, to remove those things from our heart and our lives that prevent us from being revived, but also prevent us from participating and being used by God in an awakening. I'm just so glad to be able to walk through this with you, even though it's tough stuff. Through the years, I've been asked, Matt, what are some verses or whatever that you put in your life to kind of evaluate constantly, kind of markers or warning signs or whatever you may call them in your life to help you when you begin to exhibit some of the negative aspects of love or you aren't practicing the positive aspects of love. So something I do probably daily, if not twice a day, is I go and I pray Psalm 19:14 every day. And so tonight, I just want to close tonight by praying Psalm 19:14 with you. And hopefully this is something that you can get into your rhythm and into your routine and just continually asking God to look at your heart and to help you have Christ-like thoughts and a Christ-like attitude. So thank you again for joining us. If you have any questions, contact us here at the church. Go to our website, our social media. You can watch us live at 10:45 on Sunday mornings online on our online campus, or you can be here on our physical campus at 8:30 or 10:45. Either way, we would love to see you. So let me leave you with this, and we're going to pray together. We're going to say this, Dear Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. And we all say together, Amen. God bless you. We will see you Sunday morning.